Good evening. Good to see everybody tonight. We're glad you're out again, once again, to join us for this great program. We've been blessed to have Ryan with us yesterday and today. He'll be with us through Wednesday evening if you'd like to come back and hear his other talks. Tonight's going to be a little bit different. Not so much about dinosaurs, but I'm sure there'll be a correlation somehow. But we'll see. Looking forward, though, to Ryan bringing us another message. As we begin this evening, if you would please stand, we'll sing our first song together, O Lord Most High. From the ends of the earth,
from the ends of the earth,
from the depths of the sea,
from the depths of the sea,
from the heights of the heavens,
from the heights of the heavens,
your name be praised. From the hearts of the weak,
from the hearts of the weak,
from the shouts of the strong,
from the shouts of the strong,
from the lips of your people,
from the lips of your people,
this song we raise, Lord. Throughout the endless ages, you will be crowned with praises, Lord Most High. Exalted in every nation, sovereign of all creation, Lord Most High, be magnified. Be magnified. From the ends of the earth,
from the ends of the earth,
from the depths of the sea,
from the depths of the sea,
from the heights of the heavens,
from the heights of the heavens,
your name be praised. From the hearts of the weak,
from the hearts of the weak,
from the shouts of the strong,
from the shouts of the strong,
from the lips of your people,
from the lips of your people,
this song we raise, Lord. Throughout the endless ages, you will be crowned with praises, Lord Most High. Exalted in every nation, sovereign of all creation, Lord Most High, be magnified. Be magnified. Our Heavenly Father and wonderful Lord, you are a great and awesome God, creator of all things and worthy of all our praise. We thank you for the opportunity once again to be together tonight to sing praises to you and to hear a message from your word. May what we do this evening be to your glory and honor. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Psalm 135, verse 3 says to praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Sing praise to his name, for that is pleasant. We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before his throne. We will worship righteousness, we will worship him alone. Alleluia to the King of Kings. Alleluia to the Lamb. Alleluia to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Alleluia to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Hebrews 9:26, the last part of that verse, says, "But now once at the consummation of the ages, he has been revealed to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself." Our next song is, "Jesus Paid It All."
I hear the Savior say, "Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still redeem. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow."
1 John 4:19 says, "We love because he first loved us." Last song we're going to sing tonight before Ryan comes up is, "Oh, How I Love Jesus."
There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love, who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Well, we're glad to have Ryan Cox with us and his associate Bob Dugas. And Ryan is going to come up at this time and share with us another message.
What a blessing to be with you. It was a very wonderful treat for me today to get to go see some of the sights of the area. This is one of the metro areas that I've never been to. I've been to a great number of them in the U.S. and never had the opportunity to be here in the Pittsburgh area, and so that was quite a treat. And as a history guy, and one of the things I actually, when I go around and speak and do stuff on American history, I talk about the Braddock Expedition that took place on the way over to Fort Duquesne and the battle that took place, and Fort Necessity and all that stuff and everything like that. So I got to go see some of those places I've always talked about, and I got to take pictures, and probably too many pictures, so I've got to wade through that. So, speaking of history and things like that, this topic that I want to cover with you this evening is not nearly as exciting as last night. And if you were here last night, we had an absolute lots and lots of fun with dinosaurs, talked about by dinosaurs, learned all kinds of things about dinosaurs, dinosaurs in the Bible and dinosaurs and movies and all that kind of stuff. And it was fun, dinosaurs. Just like saying the word dinosaurs. Okay, so anyway. But we need to step back from that for just one evening, and this is the evening I picked for that, and we're going to get back into dinosaurs and the flood and ice age and things like that tomorrow night, and then the following night we're going to deal with dinosaurs in history and some amazing discoveries in the last decade or two that have taken place that don't get much publicity, but reveal some incredible things about dinosaurs and the reliability of God's Word. So tonight, not as exciting, not as fun, hopefully not depressing you already, okay? but we need to deal with something that I've had the blessing to teach about and study and share for many years, but has become quite an issue once again in our culture and needs to be understood from a biblical worldview. We've talked about this. How many worldviews are there? Two, either a biblical one or a non-biblical worldview, and we need to understand this. So I actually kind of have three presentations on this. I'll do them all in one tonight. Or not. Okay. Instead, the first one I do is racism and science. What does science actually say about that? We'll sprinkle a little bit of that in here tonight. The evolution of racism, where this really got going and developed in history. And then the third one is American history and racism. And it's the exact opposite, usually, of what you hear in the media and in academia, unfortunately, about that. So to supplement for the racism in science, we have this great resource, One Race, One Blood, put out by Answers in Genesis, Master Books, very good. And then for the American History one, a little supplement, kind of material I actually don't cover because it's got a whole bunch of other stuff in it, and that is American History in Black and White by David Barton and Wall Builders. Just very, very good stuff. I highly recommend. So let's start in this way. We know that in the beginning... Yeah, all right, good. All right, I haven't lost you yet. All right. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. We then know, we go through the days of creation. On day one, then God says, let there be light. There is light. There's evening and morning. He establishes the day-night covenant. Jot this down. Jeremiah 33:22. Go look that up sometime. Jeremiah 33:22. That is where God talks about the covenant of day and night. Where is it? He establishes the day-night covenant, the 24-hour cycle. The first day of history, it specifically tells us there in Genesis 1. So he says it's good. We move on to day 2. We have this wild thing of separating waters from waters and creating this expanse and all kinds of stuff, all kinds of really cool ideas about what takes place there. And then we move on to day number 3. God reaches into the water, pulls out dry land. Out of the dry land grows what? Vegetation, exactly. And by the end of the day, hanging on trees, we have fruit. And what's in the fruit? Seed. It's amazing. On day number 3, it happens. Day number 4, God fills the expanse with all kinds of amazing stuff we are still discovering to this day. Just shows forth his handiwork as he created the greater light that we call the sun, the lesser light we call the moon, and the understatement of Scripture. And he made all the other stars as well. All the other stellar phenomena, the heavenly hosts that we can behold and keep beholding more and more. It is endless what we get to see. It's just phenomenal. Day number 5, we talked about this Sunday morning. Day number 5 and 6, he does something very unique, very special. He creates living creatures. Do you remember the Hebrew for living creatures? No, you don't. All right, that's okay. It was Kai. Say Kai, Kai Nefesh. Yes, Kai Nefesh life, blood-containing, oxygenated, animated life, living creatures. Day number 5, he makes those in the water and those with wings. Day number 6, he makes the land life. And then when he's done making animals, he said it is good, it is perfect, it's complete. He was done making animals. And then, separate from the animal kingdom, he says, now let us make man in our image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And he blessed them and told them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and have dominion over the earth. Rule over it, study it, understand this creation so you know better your Creator God. Question for you. Adam and Eve, what color were they? I'll give you the answer. Perfect. They were the perfect color. Because how did he made everything up to that point? Perfect. Everything was perfect, which means it was good, it was complete. That when I say complete, there's so much more entailed in that than just saying he was done with it. No, it was complete. It was full. It was whole. That means if we go to a science perspective, especially into genetics, we are talking about completeness, the entire genetic code, the whole genome, everything that would ever be needed for life to continue in any and all varieties that we see throughout the rest of history to this day, it was there in the beginning. It was perfect. It was full, complete. It was whole. So their color would have been perfect. We'll kind of come back to that as we wrap up this evening. Now, here's why we need to understand this and get this right, this issue. Because what a biblical worldview says. See, when we look into eternity, we read things like this. After these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could count. John says this as he beholds the throne room of God. From every nation and tribes and peoples and tongues standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palm branches in their hands. Who was before the throne of God?
Everyone.
People from all walks of life, from every background. It says this back in chapter 5. When he had taken the book, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each one holding a harp and a golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song saying, worthy are you to take the book and to break its seals, for you were slain and purchased for God. Who was slain for us? Jesus. And for whom did he do that? Every tribe and tongue and people and nation. For whom did Jesus die?
Everyone.
Who should get to hear that good news?
Everyone.
Whom should we love and cherish? Everyone. So what happened in history that changed this? Who remembers back in your old history textbook pictures like this, the triangular trade route? Who remembers that? Anybody remember that? Oh, that's not good for a history teacher. You're killing me here. This is not good. Okay. All right. Well, if you remember, there was this old thing about the triangular trade route established through the 17th, 18th centuries, okay, and how we start having this trade. You run here, then you went there and there, and you just kind of say, it's very good. That was very oversimplified. It actually looks something more like this, okay? What happened here as these great European empires began to spread throughout the world and establish their trading posts, we literally have global trade explode over the next 100, 200 years. 16th, 17th, 18th centuries, okay? I mean, 17th, 18th centuries. It just really goes wild. And there is all kinds of trade all over the place, and they're building up each of these European empires are trying to gain more and influence and building themselves up and anything like that. And here's the thing about this. In times past, before you had all this global trade and global circulation of goods, and empires competing for these resources, if you were to go back in ancient times, especially there in biblical times, who in Bible times, in the New Testament era, were slaves? Bingo! Anyone who was conquered. If in Roman times, if you were not specifically a Roman citizen, you were a slave to Rome. Now, did that mean you were in chains all the time and being forced into certain? No, it just meant you were beholden to the empire and you had to serve that empire. And actually in Rome, there was a great extent of freedom in that. Now, you didn't have ultimate freedom as if you were a Roman citizen, but it was pretty decent. Now, were all the circumstances equal? No, obviously not. But this is how it had worked for pretty much since the beginning of time, it seems like. If you got beat, if you got conquered, you became a slave to the conquerors. You're the loser, you're now a slave. Did it matter what you looked like? No, it had nothing to do with that. You just got beat. And so now you become a slave. Why would you, if you're the winner, if you're the conqueror, why would you enslave that country, that nation, that tribe? Why would you do that? Yeah, so they don't someday build themselves back up, get some allies, and come back and conquer you. That's why you did that, okay? That's how that process worked. But now during this time, when this is all going on, slavery doesn't become something of a conquest. It becomes something of commerce. Slaves aren't conquered, they are purchased. And it changes everything. Let me show you where, some little information here. This is the Transatlantic Slave Trade Database, phenomenal resource. The information and research that's gone into this. And what they show here is these are the places where the major slave trades were organized. What country do you see doesn't have much of the organizing? Yeah, North America. Why? Because there's not a country there. Just some colonies at the time. This slide here shows you where most of the slaves disembarked. Where when they came, this is where they went into staging, and then from there were sent off to all the different localities. Okay? And notice where are most of the slaves dropped off? South America and the Caribbean area. Central America. Notice where the smallest parts are. In the colonial America. Who was in charge of what happened in colonial America? Britain. The British Crown. Yet who in the world today is blamed by media and politicians and scholars, I use that term very loosely, for bringing about slavery? Who gets all the blame for it, like pretty much for the whole world? The United States of America. And that was, as a guy who's a history guy, that was good because when this was all happening, there was no United States of America. So how could we be the ones to be blamed for it? In fact, I challenge you, please go look up the rough draft of the Declaration of Independence that Thomas Jefferson penned. You've got to read the rough draft. His initial one that he proposed. Because in it, one of the biggest charges he brings against King George, and see, now I'm totally off onto the American history one, I shouldn't be on this. One of the biggest charges he brings against King George is that he canceled all of the anti-slavery laws the colonies had been passing. As they were trying to get rid of it, he would not let them. And he says, how can a Christian king be someone who has captured, captivated, and enslaved a people who never offended them and brought them to a foreign land? Calls him a prince because of his tyranny, that he's not worthy of a king. And he says, how can he do this to our fellow men? And the word men there in his rough draft is all caps. It's the only word in the whole thing that's all caps because he was emphasizing how wicked this was. And why it was worth breaking away and forming our own country because of what the king was doing regarding slavery. How many of you knew that about Thomas Jefferson? Some of you did. Thank you. For some reason, that's left out in history books today. Okay, I'm off topic. Okay. This is where the vast majority of slave holdings taken from Africa, we're talking around 12.5 million people ripped from their homes in Africa. And here's the sad thing about that. Here's what was going on. Remember, used to, who was it who became a slave? Somebody who was conquered. Here's what's happening in Africa. As these European powers are starting to take over different sections of Africa and creating their own territories, splitting up tribes, putting tribes together that are warring tribes, all this kind of stuff, it's terrible, creates absolute chaos. Africa to this day is still trying to recover from what they did to them. It's awful. They would, those African tribes who had conquered another one would bring those and sell them to the European traders. The European traders then would give them more weapons, more resources, more money to fuel them so that they would go out and do what? Conquer more and bring back and just fuel this. And this became then the epicenter of the resource of slaves. And you can see then how it was transported all across the world, with most of it going to the Caribbean and to South America there, and actually very little going to the United States area. According to the Transatlantic Slave Trade Database, of the 12.5 million, some estimates up to 15 million, Africans who were taken from their homes, 387,000 ended up in colonial America. That's like 1, 2, 3%. And yet, who gets the blame for it? Our country does. Now, what does end up happening throughout the world and in our country? The look of slavery becomes a very uniform look. It becomes the common perception that if someone's skin color was darker, they are a slave. It was just an automatic assumption then. And because of that, the feelings about, the perceptions about, the beliefs about people whose skin color just might happen to be a little darker greatly changes. Now, not everyone believed this. Thomas Jefferson didn't believe this. John Adams didn't believe this. Benjamin Franklin didn't believe this. In fact, the vast majority of the founding fathers did not believe this. George Washington went through a process. I'm off on this topic again. George Washington went through a process where he eventually changed his mind about it and thought, no, this is wrong. We need to try to find ways to end this and fix this. It had to become justified what was happening. For those who wanted to defend the institution of slavery and continue this perception of their fellow brothers and sisters of humanity, there had to be a way to explain why it was okay and actually a preferred thing to do to enslave those people. There was a resource that came along at just the right time that provided the opportunity to do that. 1859 is when Charles Darwin publishes his book entitled On the Origin of Species. 1859. Anybody knows what happens the very next year? Somebody gets elected president.
Abraham Lincoln.
What happens the following year?
Civil War.
The Civil War begins. Now, Darwin's book is not what is used to support the idea of going to civil war. But what it does is it opens the door for the intelligentsia, the academics, to begin a process of defending how they wanted to treat other people. In case you didn't know, the full title of his book is On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection or The Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life. Now, when he says that, he's talking about animal evolution. In fact, in this particular book, he really kind of stays away from human evolution because he's just trying to get the idea of evolution out there for people to accept it. And so he doesn't want to go into the whole human thing yet because he's afraid that'll just turn too many people off from reading it. So he's planting seeds here with this book on the origin of species. Now, again, his book isn't what started everyone's ideas and perceptions of I'm just going to say it, racist ideology. His book is, but guess what became the foundation for supporting those ideologies? His book. In fact, the great evolutionist, well-known evolutionist, Stephen Jay Gould, he was actually a very brilliant man, a very honest man about the shortcomings of evolution. He said this, biological arguments for racism may have been common before 1859, but they increased by orders of magnitude following acceptance of evolutionary theory. It really catapults the whole thing. And Darwin does end up really fueling that fire. See, 12 years later, he does publish a book called The Descent of Man, and here is where he does address human evolution. And 150 years ago, this past March, I believe it was, this is the 150th anniversary of this book. Well, it's got some interesting comments in it, and I don't have time to list them all. I'm just going to give you a few of them, such as this, from Mr. Charles Darwin, whose statues, by the way, have never been called upon to be torn down. Have you ever noticed that? Think about that, and think about those who they are tearing down after what I just told you. And then think about the comments that Darwin makes, such as this. But the most weighty of all the arguments against treating the races of man as distinct species is that they graduate into each other, independently in many cases, as far as we can judge, of their having intercrossed. Man has been studied more carefully than any other organic being, and yet there is the greatest possible diversity amongst capable judges whether he should be classed as a single species or race, or as 2, as 3, as 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, 15. He's quoting all the different studies that have been out there. 16, 22, 60, or as 63, according to Burke. This diversity of judgment does not prove that the races ought not to be ranked as species, but it shows that they graduate into each other and that it is hardly possible to discover clear distinctive characters between them. So the idea of race in biological terms is the idea of trying to classify human beings into different species of humanity. Race literally means subspecies. And he says the problem is we're not at a point in evolution yet where we can really nail this down. It's hard to distinguish sometimes between different races of people, different species of humanity. But someday it's going to happen. He continues. He says this. At the present day, civilized nations are everywhere supplanting barbarous nations. Isn't that a nice thought? Excepting where the climate opposes a deadly barrier, and they succeed mainly, though not exclusively, through their arts, which are the products of the intellect. The conquering nations are those who have evolved of a higher intelligence. They are more highly evolved, the conquering nations. And at that time, which nations were the ones conquering the world? The European nations. So guess whom he believes are the more highly evolved? So here's what he says. At some future period, the civilized races of man will almost certainly exterminate and replace the savage races throughout the world. At the same time, the anthropomorphous apes, as Professor Schaffhausen has remarked, will no doubt be exterminated. The break between man and his nearest allies will then be wider, for it will intervene between man and a more civilized state, as we may hope, even than the Caucasian, and some ape as low as a baboon, instead of, as now, between the Negro or Australian and the gorilla. You see, here's the problem, Charles Darwin says, is that someday we'll actually be able to tell the difference between the higher evolved humanity and the lower state primate. As of right now, we can't hardly do it, because right now you can't tell hardly any difference between somebody from Africa or from Australia, the Aborigines there, and pretty much a gorilla or an ape. You can't hardly tell the difference between them. That's
Charles Darwin, in his own words. Yet he is elevated and exalted in the halls of academia today. You want to see what the byproducts are of this? You start getting all kinds of guys popping up. You get the guy like this. Thomas Huxley shows up on the scene. He is considered to be Darwin's bulldog. He just comes infatuated with Darwin's stuff, and he'll go around all the places debating people, defending Darwin. And he publishes a series of essays entitled Evidence as to Man's Place in Nature, in which he proposes the idea of human evolution. And these are some of his drawings here of how he thought humans evolved. And as he does this, he classifies people into four race groups, okay? And he calls them the Australoids, the Negroids, the Xanthrochoic, and the Mongoloids. So he goes with Australian Aborigines, dark skin, white skin, yellow, brown skin. And that's his four subspecies of humanity. And he's one of these guys who really gets this chugging along. Then you get a lovely guy like this named Herbert Spencer. He is actually the guy who comes up with the term survival of the fittest. See, we usually give Darwin credit for that. He actually just said the fittest will survive, and he actually plagiarized a guy named Alfred Russel Wallace on that, but that's a whole other story. And so he's the one who really does this. And what he does is say, unhindered competition and survival of the fittest is the key to evolution. Therefore, we should never do anything to help those who are weaker. He was completely against charity and helping the poor and the sick and the weak and the infirmed and the handicapped. He was completely against all of that because all you're doing is hindering our evolution. You don't think this stuff has consequences? These teachings? So his writings is what becomes known as kind of social Darwinism, when you put this stuff into action into society. Francis Galton, he's a half-cousin to Darwin. Oh, he's a piece of work. He is the one who really, oh my. He founded the idea of psychometrics, measuring your mental capacities. That's going to come back to get us here in a little bit. After reading some of Darwin's stuff about heredity, he comes up with ideas of inheriting traits, inheriting the genes and all this stuff, and comes up with this idea called eugenics. Coins this term, eugenics, in 1883, which means good in birth, noble in heredity. And so, here's what he meant by that. This is how he defines eugenics. The science of improving stock, which is by no means confined to questions of judicious mating, but which, especially in the case of man, takes his cognizance of all influences that tend, in however remote a degree, to give the more suitable races, or strains of blood, a better chance of prevailing speedily over the less suitable than they otherwise would have had. You see, we don't want evolution to control us. We want to control evolution. That's the idea, the drive here behind this, so that we can dictate it and we will prevail and become even more highly advanced and more highly evolved. And we then never will become the weaker. We'll always be the fittest, and therefore we'll survive. See? Doesn't that make sense? Don't you crack your religion. I mean, this is science. So, here are some of his lovely quotes. Every long-established race has necessarily its peculiar fitness for the conditions under which it has lived, owing to the sure operation of Darwin's law of natural selection. Upon what do they all base these ideas, these eugenics ideas? Charles Darwin, natural selection. Let us then compare the Negro race with the Anglo-Saxon. These are the heroes of evolution, okay? showing a difference of not less than 2 grades between the black and white races, and it may be more. The average intellectual standard of the Negro races is some 2 grades below our own. The number among the Negroes of those whom we should call half-witted men is very large. The mistakes the Negroes made in their own matters were so childish, stupid, and simpleton-like as frequently to make me ashamed of my own species. I haven't heard a single call for statues of Francis Galton be torn down. I have no information as to the actual idiocy among the Negroes. I mean, of course, of that class of idiocy, which is not due to disease. But the Australian type is at least 1 grade below the African Negroes. It wasn't until like the 1980s, I think it was, that Australian Aborigines were allowed to participate in the Olympics with Australian people, with Australian citizens. That's how long it took for them to overcome all this. So, what many scientists then propose on how to help out humanity and its evolution was either positive eugenics, it's very positive, and that is selective breeding, actually using government interaction to decide who gets to have children and who doesn't, or negative eugenics, where we just have selective elimination of the weaker, of the less fit, of the undesirables. Guy named Ernst Haeckel loves this stuff, studies it. He develops this idea of, and I got to take a second to tell you about this, recapitulation. You're like, what in the world is that? That is not what I came tonight to hear about. Ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. It means as you are going through the developmental process in the womb, you are going through all the stages of evolution. You're going from like an itty-bitty little pond scum to advanced organisms, simple cells, to more complex cells, to some kind of little salamander thing, to then like an amphibian, then a reptile, then finally like a mammal, and poof, then you're finally born a human. And then as a human, you then go through the process of human evolution. Like when you're born, you're like a little chimp. Okay, then you grow in intelligence and you become like Homo habilis, Homo erectus, Neanderthal, and then eventually as you become an adult, you become a human being finally. Hence the idea that, you know, while you're in the womb, you're technically not really human yet. You're still going through a developmental process. We don't hear that taught today, do we? He actually did this little chart thing here where he made false sketches of embryos showing how all animal life and human life goes through the same developmental process to support his idea. In modern days, we would say he photoshopped it. This has been discredited for actually ever since he published it. The scientists of his day are like, it's totally fake. I know, I study embryos. He's totally made all this stuff up. None of that's real. Guess what's still in textbooks today? This very chart. And they will admit, they say, oh yeah, we know it's fake, it's false that he made it up, but it helps us tell the story. This is science, everybody. This is science. So this is the guy then who brings all of these ideas of Darwin to the German intelligentsia. Here's some of his ideas. The Caucasian or Mediterranean man, he totally made that one up, has from time immemorial been placed at the head of all the races of men as the most highly developed and perfect. This species alone, with the exception of the Mongolian, has had an actual history. It alone has attained to that degree of civilization which seems to raise men above the rest of nature. He is read and adored by a guy named Alfred Rosenberg, who was appointed by a guy named Adolf Hitler. You ever heard of him? Okay. In 1923, as leader of the National Socialist Movement. They always wanted to make sure they were called socialists because that was a much more acceptable term. It was the propaganda of the Americans that called them Nazis, but no, they were never Nazis. They were socialists. Because socialists are good. In 1934, Hitler appoints Alfred Rosenberg as the cultural, spiritual, and educational leader of the Reich. As the Nazi Party's chief racial theorist, he's the one who developed Hitler's racial ladder. Who's at the bottom, who's at the top. And that's how they decided, you know, who was the master race and who was acceptable and who wasn't, who needed to be exterminated and who didn't. And this is his thought on religion. He believed, first of all, he just hated Christianity, but he believed that Jesus was an Indo-European Nordic white guy. And the reason he was persecuted and crucified is because the Jews hated the white guy. What was Jesus? Jewish. He was Jewish, descendant of Abraham. So, German religion was to have the National Reich Church of Germany claim exclusive control over all churches. The government would tell the churches what they can and cannot do. Boy, I'm glad we don't have a country like that. Cease publication of Bibles. Crucifixes, Bibles, and saints were to be removed from all church buildings. Mein Kampf placed on the altars, on the pulpits, as, quote, to the German nation and therefore to God as the most sacred book. And, of course, crosses were to be replaced with what? Swastikas. By the way, if you think this was only going on in Germany, back in America, you get people like this. Charles Davenport, biologist, professor of zoology at Harvard, considered to be one of the leaders of the American eugenics movement, along with several other guys. Big fan of Francis Galton, the guy we just read earlier, Darwin's half-cousin. He founds the Eugenics Record Office in 1910 with funding from the Carnegie Institution and the Harriman Railroad Fortune. 1911, he publishes his book, Heredity in Relation to Eugenics. That becomes one of the most popular college textbooks in America. He also establishes the American Breeders Association, and we're not talking dogs, in 1906 to, quote, investigate and report on heredity in the human race and emphasize the value of superior blood and the menace to society of inferior blood. Many celebrities of the time were parts of these groups. Many other charitable, religious, social groups got involved. The National Federation of Women's Club, Women's Christian Temperance Union, National League of Women Voters, all were big supporters of eugenics, and sadly, many African-American organizations were. And African-American universities and colleges and leaders in the communities were supporters of it because they are being told this is the latest science that's going to help humanity. It's going to end poverty. It's going to end drunkenness. It's going to end abuse because we're going to get rid of all that bad stuff through the incredible science of eugenics. Here's one of the leaders of that. 1916, she opens up her birth control clinic in Brooklyn. She targeted with her clinics low income, poverty stricken, and minority communities with those clinics. She spoke at a 1926 KKK rally to great fanfare. Got many more invitations to come to other ones. Founded the American Birth Control League in 1921, which changed its name in 1942 to Planned Parenthood. I haven't heard any calls for defunding of Planned Parenthood, have you? I don't understand why. You go to county fairs and carnivals and see exhibits like this, posters like this, unfit human traits, the triangle of life. If all marriages were eugenic, we could breed out most of the unfitness in three generations. That was by the American Eugenics Society. Or you could go to one like this, the American Philosophical Society. How long are we Americans to be so careful with the pedigree of our pigs and chickens and cattle and then leave the ancestry of our children to chance or to blind sentiment. Come on, you farmers ought to know this. You know, we got to breed out the bad traits so we have the good traits left to improve the stock. So, 32 states end up enacting eugenics programs. By 1937, Fortune magazine reported that 2/3 of poll respondents supported eugenic sterilization of mental defectives. 63% supported sterilization of criminals. Only 15% of Americans opposed this. From 1907 to 1963, over 64,000 individuals were forcibly sterilized under eugenic legislation. 3/5 were women. California performed nearly 20,000 of them. North Carolina's program sterilized anyone who had an IQ score of less than 70. Remember Francis Galton measuring psychometrics? Do you know why the IQ score was invented? To help us weed out those who were superior and those who were inferior for our eugenics programs. It was used for immigration policy in the 1920s and 1930s. And a new quota on immigration was placed. And please don't confuse what I'm saying and applying it to the current immigration issue. That's not what I'm doing at all. But immigration policy was changed in 1934, I believe it was, to reflect immigration quotas of 1926, because that was the year that we had the lowest amount of Jewish immigration. And so we put a quota on that, on people coming from different countries, how many could come, and we put an IQ test to it that they had to pass in order to get in. And it's estimated by the scholars who studied this that from about 1934 through 1945, we turned down about 6 million Jews from entering the United States of America. 6 million. That number ought to ring a bell in your mind. How many were killed in the Holocaust? 6 million. You don't think this stuff has consequences? That idea of evolution's okay? 1911, Carnegie Institute explored 18 methods for removing defective genetic attributes. Method number 8 was euthanasia. The most commonly suggested method of euthanasia was gas chambers, but many thought that America probably wasn't ready for such quite widespread programs like that. Guess who was? Germany. Nazi Germany. Therefore, eugenics doctors would engage in lethal neglect. Well, if the fittest will survive. Or would do things like in a mental institute in Lincoln, Illinois, infect milk with tuberculosis. And those who would drink it and survive, they're obviously the fittest. And those who didn't, well, you know, that's tough. They obviously didn't have what it took. You see, we're breeding out the weak. Euthanasia Society of America was founded in 1938, and I believe New Mexico just a week or two ago enacted their new euthanasia laws. Nothing's changed, really, has it? See, there were stories like this that not until really in the last 30, 40 years did we ever hear about some of these stories where there'd be a couple kids out playing on the hillside, out in the hill country of North Carolina, and a car would come in from town, just pick up the kids, take them, go back into town. Mom and dad have no idea. And then several hours later, they would show back up and drop the kids off. They'd been taken into town to the clinic and sterilized because their family was poor. And people just now have been starting to tell those stories because they were so embarrassed and ashamed of what had happened to them throughout their life. That happened all throughout our country, United States of America. Throughout the world, there were things entitled Exotic Population Exhibits in Zoos. Starting in the 1870s, you could go to human zoo exhibits throughout the world, like Paris, Hamburg, Antwerp, Barcelona, London, Milan, New York, and Warsaw. Hundreds of thousands of people seeing these exhibits. In 1896, the Cincinnati Zoo invited 100 Sioux Native Americans to establish a village for 3 months. 1904, Apache natives from the Philippines and the famous Otabinga were brought to the St. Louis World Fair. Ota is this gentleman right here of these five, and then this is him later on in life. Ota's wife and two children were killed back in Africa when he was on an expedition as a Belgian group that was in charge of rubber production in that area. It was not happy with that village, so came in to teach him a lesson, and he lost his wife and children. When he came back, he was captured and taken in as a slave. This is early 1900s. He was seen by a gentleman named Samuel Verner, who had been sent by the committee for the St. Louis World Fair to go to Africa and see about bringing back some people to bring back to the United States for a cultural exhibit. Now, I'll have to say, Samuel Verner had the idea of bringing people to educate and to share with people about how amazing the cultures are around the world. That's not how the exhibits ended up, though, and he was very upset about it. So he brought these five gentlemen back, and that's them in the 1904 picture. And then after the World's Fair, they were allowed to go back home. And Samuel Verner went with him. Ota really had enjoyed his time with Samuel Verner because of how nice he treated them and getting to see the United States of America, especially at the World's Fair. I mean, today if you went to the St. Louis World's Fair of 1904, you would be amazed at the things you saw. It was just phenomenal. So Samuel was like, well, would you like to come back and spend maybe another year or two touring and seeing stuff? He's like, yeah, I would, absolutely. And so he does. Eventually, he takes a job at the Bronx Zoo in New York, where he is supposedly employed to help do things around the zoo. Well, a guy named William Temple Hornaday is the zoo director, and he notices how Ota is getting a lot of attention from people. So he and some of the workers at the zoo ask Ota, hey, would you be willing to set up your cot in the primate house and like shoot your bow and arrow for people? And he's like, yeah, okay. By the way, there's never been any record found where he was ever paid for his time there. And so he did. He slept in the monkey house, and a sign was put up that said this, quote, "The African pygmy Otabinga, age 23, height 4 feet 11, weight 103 pounds from the Cassia River, Congo Free State, South Central Africa, exhibited each afternoon during September." The secretary of the New York Zoological Society was Madison Grant. He was one of the guys listed earlier with Charles Davenport. And he was an avid evolutionist, racist, eugenicist. He helped fancy up the exhibit of Otabinga. And it wasn't long. This exhibit didn't last much longer than a month. Do you know who spoke out against this? Christians were livid because he was being portrayed as a missing link and supporting the idea of evolution and a terrible treatment of their fellow man. They put a lot of pressure on the governor and on William Temple Hornaday. He didn't really want to give in, but then threats of lawsuits and legal action and everything, they finally released him to go about walking around the zoo. And then finally, one of the preachers of the area, a guy named James Gordon, Batman fans just got excited there. Different guy. James Gordon ends up taking Ota into his custody. into his care, helping him get cleaned up and get ready, actually help him start learning his English better, get education, gets a job. He actually does. He starts working for a factory in Lynchburg, Virginia to save up money so he can return home someday. And things were actually going pretty good. Things were doing quite well. And he just had raised enough money to go back to his home when World War I broke out and all passenger traffic to Africa was canceled. For 2 years, he kind of developed a depression that just kept coming on. He couldn't get over it. And on March 20th, 1916, at the age of 32 or 33, he went outside, created a little ceremonial fire, sat down, and shot himself in the heart. You want to know how William Temple Hornaday is memorialized today? The guy who did this at the zoo, at the exhibit? If you go to the all-wonderful, all-knowing Wikipedia, it says this about William Temple Hornaday. This is the opening. William Temple Hornaday was an American zoologist, realtor, conservationist, author, poet, and songwriter. He revolutionized museum exhibits by displaying wildlife in their natural settings and is credited with discovering the American crocodile and with saving the American bison and the Alaskan fur seal from extinction. Oh, isn't he a wonderful guy? You have to go way down in the article to read anything about what happened with Otobinga. I don't know what your thoughts are about it. And quite frankly, I don't care. But I am grateful we had a civil rights movement in the United States. Because most people today have no idea why we needed to have one. Because this history has been swept under the rug so that we don't know the circumstances of what was going on during that time. How many of you knew all this stuff about the eugenics movement in the United States before tonight? Three, maybe. Why is this not front and center in education today? I think that's kind of answered. Now, was everything in the civil rights movement perfect and wonderful and everything went exact? No, okay. There were some negative things, but there were a lot of positive things. This needed to happen to overcome some of this junk, this filth that was happening in our society. And it was led by a lot of Christian people. Sadly, unlike what's been going on lately in our country over the last year. If only the words of Dr. King, that we'd be judged by the content of our character and not by the color of our skin. Because you see, science has finally figured this out. As it's like, well, what took it so long? It was interesting. At the 1997 Advancement of Science Convention in Atlanta, it stated that race is a social construct. It's an idea. It's not a scientific thing. Derived mainly from perceptions conditioned by events of recorded history, and it has no basic biological reality. There is no such thing as subspecies of humanity. When they were working on the Human Genome Project, they actually did not discover anything about this, but it made for good politics, it made for good PR, okay, when you actually look into what took place in the mapping of the genome. But so this article was put out, but hey, it said something good. Those working on mapping the human genome announced that they had put together a draft of the entire sequence of the human genome, and the researchers had unanimously declared there is only how many races? One, the human race. Amen. This was just very recent. This was February 2016 in Science Journal publication. It's talking about a race in human genetics. And it said this, and I was like, wow, this is really good. In the wake of the sequencing of the human genome in the early 2000s, genome pioneers and social scientists alike called for an end to the use of race as a variable in genetic research. We believe the use of biological concepts of race in human genetic research, so disputed and so mired in confusion, is problematic at best and harmful at worst. It is time for biologists to find a better way. Amen. When I was in biology class, my secular evolutionary biology textbook, college-level biology textbook, I opened it up. I didn't bring it with me. I forgot to. And this diagram on the left was on one of the pages in one of the peanut squares here. And I looked at that and I was like, oh, that's cool. I'm like, that's really cool, talking about variations of skin color throughout humanity and the genetics that's involved in that and some of the biological factors that deal with that. I was like, that's really cool. Because here's my question. At which point are you a different race? Are you a different subspecies of humanity? Because, you know, back in the 1800s, they did try to do that. If you're like 1/16th or something like that of African descent, then it doesn't matter what you look like because you had bad blood. Really? But then the part that I almost fell out of my chair in class, I was like, no way. Look at the top of the diagram. The original mother and father that had the full genetic code to produce everyone we see today and all their beautiful varieties. I wouldn't raise my hand and say, hey, by the way, I know the names of those two people. Who were they? Honey. What color were they? Perfect. You would think this would be going away. The problem, it has been so enshrined into the academia and into the science for so long, these fundamentals of evolution, that they just can't get rid of it altogether. There's a spiritual application. We can't get rid of all the filth sent by ourselves. Who's the one who does that for us? Jesus does. They don't have Jesus, so these things are still lingering. And so when you look at human evolution, you get displays like this. You can go to almost any natural history museum that has an exhibit on human evolution. And for me, having studied this, this is the thing that sticks out every time. I've yet to go to one that it wasn't this way. What do you notice about the color of the skin and the display of the evolutionary process? Oh, he starts off as dark as possible to get to as light as possible. Hello, what are you trying to say? In fact, there was one that was discovered a while back called Homo naledi. In fact, anybody remember? I'm sorry. Anybody remember back in the old days in history classes that they had human origins out of the Fertile Crescent? Anybody remember that? You're old enough to remember that? Okay. By the way, that's not in books anymore. It's now out of Africa. Human evolution came out of Africa. We evolved out of Africa. Do you know why? Yes, you do now after this seminar. National Geographic did a special in 2015 about this missing link that was discovered called Homo naledi, and we're at the end now. We're about done here. Called Homo naledi, totally been refuted as a missing link, as every one of them has, by secular scientists, by the way. And I want you to look at how they came to the conclusion as to how it should look. Because remember, all they've got is a skull, which, by the way, is a pieced together skull from lots of fragments. They didn't have an actual intact skull, okay? So notice some of these things. Okay, so like example here on this one, the brown is what was actually there. The rest of it was filled in, okay? All right, to make these things, that's how this works, okay? So watch carefully and listen and read some little subtitles I put in there as to how they go about making some of these displays and how they specifically, this is National Geographic, did for Homo naledi, okay? Check this out.
From the very beginning, this was such a fascinating ancestor to work on because it's such a weird combination of primitive and more human-like traits. You start with a skull, and certain measurements on that skull tell you some things about the soft tissue of the face. The ears are a boondoggle, really, for people like me who reconstruct heads, because there's not much information a skull can tell you about the form of the ears.
That's actually not true.
It's not true with noses. Naledi had a spine right at the base of the nasal opening that projects out of the nasal cavity. And that tells you that there is at least somewhat of a projecting nose. And that's a human characteristic. And skin color is a problem I obviously have to deal with. Listen. When I'm thinking about the skin color that should be appropriate for a specific prehistoric hominid, I look to the populations that are living there today. In this case, I'm dealing with a form that lived in South Africa, so the San people were a good model for me to base the idea of skin color on.
They can't get rid of this. It's so ingrained in
the actual pattern of the hair, we simply don't have that kind of information in the fossil record, so I'm making a guess there, and I'm using commonalities in the hair pattern and faces that you see in great apes and humans. It's a wonderful thing to be in the position of being the guy who figures out what some ancient species
look what he's holding next to it.
Before looked like.
A gorilla.
So the final gorilla form face. Of a reconstruction of a face is often a surprise to me. It's the cumulative result of all these individual anatomical decisions, but it has this big ta-da moment at the end of the reconstruction, which is almost like the end of a mystery story where an identity is revealed.
The eyes.
And that's an exciting moment for me to have that often surprising moment of seeing the face as an entirety for the first time.
Everything done to that is to make you look at that and see these things being cued, trigger your mind. That's like, well, wait, there are things that look, you don't even realize it, that look human. They don't look human. They look like a gorilla. It's how much of it was actually based on science? None of it. None of it. And that whole thing about the ears, in 2018, the Journal of Evolution said there was middle ear bones in that skull that were chimp ear bones. What was it he was working on? A chimp! All the way! 100% from the beginning! Science sometimes gets it figured out. Sometimes it doesn't. Is there any source we could go to where we know it would be right 100% of the time? Thank you, right there, yes. And by the way, guess what it has said about this topic from every passage, from day one all the way through? He made, he created from one man every nation of mankind. How many races does the Bible say there are? One. The human race. To live on all the faces of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation, that they should seek God. If perhaps they might grope for Him and find Him, though He's not far from each one of us. For in Him we live and move and exist, as even some of your own poets have said. For we, all of us, are His children. I cannot express to you enough the historical significance, cultural rattling, earthquake shattering, whatever you want to describe, of the passage of Genesis of Galatians 3, 28 and 29. For all of you who have been baptized into Christ, have been clothed with Christ, there is neither then Jew nor Greek, slave or free, male or female. You're one in Christ. Who is precious in God's sight?
Everyone.
Doesn't matter your background, your nationality, your income, your social status, your sin. I don't care what it is you've done. Guess who loves you? Jesus does. Guess who we should love and serve and share the good, glorious, joyful, saving news of Jesus Christ. Father, may we be convicted this night that we are your children. And there's nothing any of us has ever done that could change that fact. Father, may we look at our fellow brothers and sisters of humanity as you do, saved and lost, but all precious in your sight. May we possibly tonight have a new conviction, a new fire in our souls, your Spirit compelling us tonight that we need to share Jesus. This world is dark. It needs the light. May it shine so bright in our lives because of how we treat one another here in this place and out everywhere we go, that people can't help but see that light. May we have a renewed commitment tonight to the gospel, the importance of your church, and her doing the work she is to do, so that maybe with just how we love someone and share with them and help them and serve them, the streets of heaven might be just a little fuller. May that be our passion and our drive, because we know of your passion for us, for it was displayed so heartwarming, heartbreaking, heart-changingly on the cross of Calvary. We love you. May we serve you. In Jesus' name. And those who would love their brother said,
coming up to get ready for our invitation. Again, thank you, Ryan, for your studies and the presentation. Very thorough and good. Appreciate it. And as I sat there and thought of these things, it just broke my heart how, again, with the two worldviews out there, how what the prophet tells us, you know, good is made evil and evil is made good. Even though we have this information, even though we know these things are out there, it's just people won't repent. They won't change it. And again, they have some means or some end game to still get across with some of these things that they're perpetrating and pushing and propagating upon our society. It's sad. But as we see there, again, you know, from the scriptures and that our brother shared with us, we're all of one blood. We're all of one race. And that's wonderful. We're all not only flesh and blood, but we are also soul and spirit, which is going to live forever in one of two places, in heaven or in hell. And Jesus came for all people and died on the cross for all people so that we could go to heaven. He wants us to. He loves us so much. He created us and gave us life, and he wants us to be saved. And the scriptures tell us that if we believe in him, believe that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God, we're willing to confess that before men, that we will repent of our sins and turn from this world and its evils, and turn to God, and turn to what's right, and then be immersed, be buried our old man of sin, reach the blood of Christ there in that watery grave, and receive the forgiveness of our sins, and receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. then we're a Christian. And we're a part of that family of God. And he wants everyone, just as the passages were read there out of the book of Revelation, saying there's going to be people of every tribe and nation and tongue, and they're in heaven. So it doesn't matter who we are. We all want to be there. Everyone we know, everyone we see, everybody is a candidate to go to heaven, and we need to share that with them. If you're here tonight and you've never been obedient to the gospel and you know what you need to do, we're going to be, the men are going to come and sing our invitation song. We're only going to use one verse of Jesus Saves again this evening, and the water's warm. We have robes ready. I can take your confession. We can go back and we can immerse you in a matter of minutes, and the Lord will add you to his church, to his family. So we want to extend that invitation to you. Jesus loves you, and he's standing there at the door. And he's knocking, but there's no doorknob on the outside. It's you. You have to let him in. You have to accept him. And the church says, come. And the bride says, come. And the Spirit says, come. And Jesus, he's on that cross saying, come. I'm dying for you to forgive you of your sins. Accept what I did for you. If you're here as we stand and sing and you need to accept the Lord tonight and the gospel, please come.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward 'tis our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Quickly. Darkness.